Your Bibles, if you will, and open with me today to the book of Exodus, and we're going to chapter number 33. Exodus chapter number 33. I want to welcome you to the final week of our study, where we have been considering for 2 months Moses, a man for the ages. Most of you are aware, because you've been here for most of these weeks, some of you have been here for every one of these weeks, that over the last 8 weeks, we have been considering what it looks like to live a life that could be defined as a life for the ages. And so we've had a working thesis that has been driving our discussions and keeping our focus on point every single one of these weeks. Most weeks, we've said it out loud together. And I want us to do that again today. This will be the last time that we do it. And honestly, by now, you probably ought to be able to say it pretty much by memory, but I won't put you to the test. They're going to put it on the screen. And I want us to say this out loud together with some conviction, all right? This is the last time you'll get to do it, so do it with some energy. Let's say it. People for the ages are those who live rightly and lead wisely so that their lives will still influence others long after they're gone. So this is the idea, right? We've learned it every week. That in my little world, in my circle of influence, I want to live in such a way, lead and influence others in such a way that when I'm dead and gone and buried and been in heaven for a long time, that on earth people will still be being changed by the influence of my life. Now this phrase, as most of you remember, was coined by Edwin Stanton, who was the Secretary of War in 1865 when Abraham Lincoln was assassinated. And when Lincoln drew his last breath, Stanton said, "Now he belongs to the ages." And what Stanton was saying was that the president may be dead, but he has led our nation in such a way that for the ages to come, he will still continue to have impact and to have influence. So this is our goal, to live that kind of life. Now, we don't want to be like Abraham Lincoln. Lincoln's not our model. Moses is our model. And so for all of these weeks, we've been working through some of the highlights of the book of Exodus and learning the characteristics and the virtues of the life of Moses. Let me remind you of the seven we've considered so far. And again, you ought to know these because we've been reviewing them each week. Let me do it one final time today. We learned in week number one that Moses was chosen by God, that the Lord chose him and providentially worked in his life. Secondly, we learned that Moses was being changed by God. Every person whom God chooses, God will also change. All of us need to be transformed. Number three, we learned that Moses was called to a specific purpose or role. God determined his destiny in the same way that he does ours. Number four, we learned that Moses was a man of great faith, and that he hadn't always been a man of great faith. In fact, in the beginning of our study, we saw that he was a man of very weak faith, but his faith grew. God gave him great courage, primarily in the contests with Pharaoh. We learned in week number five that Moses was a man of deep humility. And we said that humility is essential to greatness, that if we're going to be great in the kingdom, we must walk in humility. In week number six, we learned in Exodus 15 that Moses was a man passionate about praise. And we learned that he sang the song that has been memorialized, sang even until today throughout the land of Israel, this song of Moses. And then last week, in week number seven, we talked about the fact that Moses cared deeply about holiness. He cared about the holiness of God and that the holiness of God would be reflected in his people. In fact, if you'll look in Exodus chapter 32, you're in chapter 33, so just one page back, look at verse number 19 of Exodus 32. This was the verse we considered last week where it says, "It came to pass that as soon as Moses came near unto the camp that he saw the golden calf that Aaron had made for the people to worship. He saw the dancing," or that is the Israelites worshiping this golden calf, dancing around it in idolatry. And verse number 19 says that Moses' anger waxed hot and that he cast those tables of stone, those stone tablets with the Ten Commandments, out of his hands and broke them beneath the mountain. It is that Moses was so angry because God's a holy God who has demanded of his people that his holiness would be reflected in them. And it only took 40 days. It was 40 days after hearing the commandments that they had already broken two of them, violated God's commands and his will, and had moved away from him and toward idolatry. So it's out of the failure of the people in chapter 32 that a principle emerges, a lesson emerges in chapter 33, which all of us need to learn. And this is where we're going to focus today. I want you to write the principle or the lesson down, and then we're going to talk about it. It's really simple. It's this. It is that the effect of sin is separation from God. The effect of sin is separation from God. Here's another way to say it. The result of sin is separation from God, or the consequence of sin is separation from God. There's rebellion in chapter 32. Watch what happens beginning in verse 1 of chapter 33. Verse 1 says, "And the Lord said unto Moses, Depart and go up from here, you and the people which you have brought out of the land of Egypt, unto the land which I swear unto Abraham, Isaac, and to Jacob, saying unto thy seed, will I give it. And I will send an angel before you, and I will drive out from before you the Canaanites and the Amorites and the Hittites and the Perizzites and the Hivites and the Jebusites, all the inhabitants of the land. I am sending you," verse 3, "unto a land flowing with milk and honey." Now stop right there. Here's what God is saying in these three verses. I will keep my word. I've promised to give you this land. I've promised to drive out the inhabitants. This is where you will dwell. I'm going to keep my promise to you because that's what I do. I keep my word, God says. But, verse 33, look at it, or verse 3, in the middle of the verse, "For I will not go up in the midst of thee." Will you take your pen if you're a note taker? Underline that statement. "For I will not go up with you." Why? Why wasn't God going to go? Well, it's very clear. You keep reading the verse. He says, "For you are a stiff-necked people." That's why. "You're a sinful, rebellious people, I gave you my law. It took you a full 40 days to violate the first two commandments and to move away from me in rebellion. As a result of your sin," I'm going to keep my word to you, "but as a result of your sin, I am not going to go up with you." clearly in chapter 33, you see the result of sin, God's their separation from God. Now, this is illustrated beginning in verse number 7 as well, chapter 33, verse 7. Well, the Bible says that Moses took the tabernacle and pitched it outside the camp. Now, this is not the full and final tabernacle. That hasn't been constructed yet. This is just a tent of meeting or a tabernacle of the congregation, one tent. He says that Moses set it up outside the camp, afar off from the camp. He called it the tabernacle of the congregation. And it came to pass that everyone that would seek the Lord went out unto the tabernacle of the congregation, which was where? It was outside of the camp. So again, this tent where God will meet, if somebody wants to seek the Lord, they've got to go out there to see him, is not in the midst of the people. It is where? It's away from the people. So in verses 1 through 3, he says, look, I'm not going with you. And in verse number 7, he says, even my dwelling place, my tabernacle, my tent, is not going to be among you. Here's the principle. You got it? The effect of sin is separation from God. Now, this is a very simple biblical reality. And in fact, it's one of the first biblical lessons that you learn in the scriptural narrative. You know in Genesis chapter number 3 that Adam and Eve have lived in absolute innocence and perfection with God for some number of days. We don't even know how long. But they have this period of time with God before Genesis chapter 3 where they are sinless, right? They're perfectly innocent. They're naked. They don't even know they're naked. They're so innocent. There's no shame. There's no embarrassment. There's nothing to hide or cover. They're totally pure before God. Every day God comes walking in the midst of the garden. He calls their name and they run to him. Every day they're perfectly in fellowship with him until chapter 3. And what happens in chapter 3? In chapter number 3, both Adam and Eve sin and disobey God. And what is the immediate, instantaneous result? They're ashamed of their nakedness. They sew fig leaves together to cover themselves. They're mad at each other, and they run and hide themselves in the midst of the garden. And when God comes calling their name, they no longer run to him, they run from him. They're no longer open and honest and pure before him. They're lying and hiding and covering up and running from his presence. And God has to go on a search for them. Not that God didn't know where they were, but he has to come because they are hiding from him. This is the result of sin. Sin separates us from God. Now, this is a problem for every person in the room. In fact, would you look at your neighbor right now and just tell him, you got a problem. Tell him. You got a problem. Yeah. And the reason your neighbor has a problem is because your neighbor is a sinner, right? And some of you said, I've been married to him 30 years. I knew that a long, long time ago, right? So the person sitting on your right is a sinner, and the person sitting on your left is a sinner, and the person behind you is a sinner, and the guy talking to you is a sinner, and James on the camera is a sinner, and the people hiding out in the projection room upstairs are sinners. Every person is a sinner. And if sin separates us from God, then we have a major problem. Now, this separation that the Bible teaches us about is expressed throughout the Bible in a lot of different ways. I want you to write down some words, okay? Here's the first one. Write down the word death, okay? The Bible says that as a result of our sin, we die. And it doesn't mean death in a casket only. That's our view of it. But it is eternal death, eternal separation from the life of God. Romans 6:23 says this, for the wages of sin is, say the word, it's death. Yeah, it's separation, eternal death. Secondly, write down the word departure. Departure. What the Bible says is because we are sinners, we will be required on the day of judgment to depart from God. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 7 and verse 23 that on the day of judgment there will be people who will hear these words, depart from me, for I never knew you. In other words, get out of my sight, get out of my presence, you cannot be here, depart from me. Are you listening? Sin brings eternal separation from God and eternal death, eternal departure from God because we are cast out of his presence. Then there's a third word to write down. It's the word darkness. Darkness. We know that the Bible says that Jesus is the light of the world and that God is light and life, and in him is no darkness at all. And yet, because of sin, Matthew 22:13 says that there will come a word on the day of judgment where God will say to people, or say of people, cast them into outer darkness. So sin, the effect, the result, the consequence of sin is separation from God, eternal death, eternal departure from the life of God, and eternal darkness away from the light of God. This is the result of sin. Now, I need to take a quick survey, so let me ask a question. I want you to respond verbally with a loud amen. If you know Jesus Christ as your Savior, would you shout amen?
Amen.
Amen. And if you do, you will never die. And if you do, you will never be commanded to depart from his presence. And if you do, you will never encounter or endure eternal darkness. Because those who know Jesus will not die or be cast away from his presence. And God's people ought to say, amen.
Amen.
Praise God for that. And so you may be thinking then, well, awesome, that's great news. If I'm saved, sin's no longer an issue for me, right? I have no worries or no problems or no struggles or effects of sin in my life. Is that right? No, that's not right. Because there is an effect of sin in the life of a child of God. And in fact, this is what's illustrated in Exodus chapter number 33, because even though it's Old Covenant, it is God's people, Israel, his sons and his daughters, who have sinned. And you see the effect of that in chapter number 33. You've written down death, departure, and darkness. Write down one more word. This is the effect of sin in the life of a believer. It is distance. Distance. You see, the Bible says to us that when we sin, when we live in unconfessed sin, when we walk in rebellion, when we quench the Holy Spirit and we live life according to our terms, defying the will of God and the word of God and the conviction of the Holy Spirit as a Christian, when we do that, if we're truly born again, we're not in danger of eternal death or darkness or having to depart from him, because it doesn't change our position as his child, but it does affect our relationship and our fellowship with him. In other words, when we sin as a child of God, we move away from God. We're in this fellowship with him. When we sin, we move away from him. We don't cease to be his child, but our joy and our fellowship and our usefulness for him is affected. It's the same way if you have a son or a daughter who's no longer a child that's just doing childish little things, but a son or a daughter who has matured to adolescence or teen years or even adulthood. And if that son or daughter steps away from you, if they sin against you, do they cease to be your child? Well, not at all. But does your relationship with them struggle? Do you find distance in that relationship and a brokenness in that relationship and the fellowship being difficult? Yes, you do. And it is the same way in our relationship with God. Not death, not darkness, not departure, but we live at a guilty distance with him. Now, this is what's happening in Exodus chapter number 33 with God's people, the Israelites. And here's what's interesting that you'll find in this chapter. It is that Moses could never be content that there would be distance between God's people and the Lord. He was passionate. He longed that that God's presence would be among them, that they would walk in deep fellowship with him. And this is at least one virtue of Moses that made him a man for the ages. Listen carefully. If you're listening, say amen. Listen to this. If you want to be a man or a woman for the ages, where long after you're gone, your life will still be having influence, this is required. You must press into your relationship with the Lord and never be content to just live your life on your own terms, trusting that you're going to heaven, but you're doing what you want to do in this life. You must be passionate as Moses was about maintaining this fellowship and this intimate relationship with the Lord. And so I want to show you this in Exodus chapter 33, beginning in verse number 12. You follow along as I read the word of the Lord. And Moses, verse 12, and Moses said unto the Lord, "See, you have said unto me, bring up this people, and you have not let me know whom you will send with me. Yet you have said, I know thee by name, and you have also found grace in my sight. Now therefore, I pray thee, if I have truly found grace in your sight, show me your way, that I may know you fully, and that I may find grace in your sight, and consider or remember that this nation is thy people." And God said in verse 14, "My presence shall go with thee, and I will give thee rest." And he said unto him, "If thy presence go not with me, then carry us not up from here. For wherein shall it be known here that I and thy people have found grace in thy sight? Is it not in that you go with us? So shall we be separated. The distinguishing mark of this nation will be this, that I and thy people will be separated from all the other people that are upon the face of the earth. The distinguishing mark is that your presence is with us." The Lord said unto Moses in verse 17, "I will do this thing also that you have spoken. For you have found grace in my sight, and I know you by name." Verse 18, and Moses said, "I beseech thee, I beg you, show me your glory." And God said, "I will make all my goodness to pass before thee, and I will proclaim the name of the Lord before thee, and will be gracious to whom I will be gracious, and show mercy on whom I will show mercy." And he said, "You cannot see my face. There shall no man see me and live." But the Lord said, "Behold, there is a place by me, and you shall stand upon a rock. And it shall come to pass that while my glory passes by, that I will put you in a cleft of the rock, in a little grotto or a cave or a little indention within the rock. I will press you back into the rock, and I will cover you with my hand while I pass by. And then I will take away my hand as I'm passing by, and you shall see not my face, not the fullness of my glory, but you will see the back parts of my glory, but my face shall not be seen." Now, a few minutes ago, I asked you, if you're a note taker, to underline in verse number 3 this statement, God saying, "For I will not go up in the midst of thee." I want you to go over in verse number 14, and I want you to underline these words, God speaking, "My presence shall go with thee." I love this. In verse number 3, God says, "Take the people, go up to the land, I'll drive out the inhabitants, but I'm not going." In verse number 14, God says, "I'm going with you." Now, in my Bible, those two verses are almost opposite of one another in the two columns in my Bible, so I drew an arrow between them just to connect them together so that every time I turn to this page, I'll see it, because I want to know what in the world made the difference. What happened that from verse number 3, God saying, "I'm not going with you," and in verse number 14, God saying, "I will go with you," what in the world caused the restoration of this relationship? And I think you're going to see very clearly the answer to that question. Write it down. Let me give you the first thing, and it's this. Their relationship with God was restored because Moses interceded for the people. Write that down. Moses interceded for the people. Moses was the mediator of the old covenant, and so Moses went before God on behalf of the people. God says in verse number 3, "You take them and you go up to Canaan, but I'm not going." I love verse number 15. Do you see verse 15? Moses says, "If you're not going, I'm not going." Don't you love that answer? I mean, here's translation: "I ain't going nowhere without you. If you're telling me to leave here and go up to Canaan, but you're not going, I don't want to move without you." The Bible says that Moses went in and he interceded for the people. Let me show it to you in verse number 7. The Bible says that Moses pitched this tabernacle outside of the camp, and anybody that wanted to seek the Lord had to go outside the camp to seek him in this tabernacle. So verse number 8 says, and it came to pass that when Moses went out to the tabernacle. So he pitches the tabernacle out there, and then he goes out to seek the Lord. Well, what's going to happen out there? Look at verse number 9. It came to pass that when Moses entered into the tabernacle, the cloudy pillar descended, stood at the door of the tabernacle, and the Lord talked with Moses. Well, what did they talk about? Well, look what the Bible says in verse number 13. Moses says to God while he's out in the tabernacle, "Now therefore I pray thee, if I found grace in your sight, show me your way that I may know thee, that I may find grace in your sight, and consider that this nation is your people." So Moses goes out to the tabernacle, talks to God, who has said, "I'm not going with you," and says to God, "Don't forget, these people are your people." He also says, "How is it going to be known that we are your people? What's going to differentiate us from all the other people of the world? Is it not that you are there," verse 16, "that you are there going with us?" Moses, when God's relationship with the people was strained, when in sin they moved away from God, when God said, "I'm not going among you because you're a stiff-necked and a rebellious people," Moses went before God for the people, and Moses interceded for them. And in the same way, did you know that the Bible teaches that in the new covenant, in our relationship with God, Jesus Christ is our intercessor before God the Father? A few minutes ago, you told your neighbor, "You got a problem." Well, let me tell you God's solution to the problem. Jesus is our intercessor. The Bible says in 1 John chapter 2, verse 1, it says, "My little children, these things write I unto you, that you sin not. But if you sin," we have an advocate, an attorney, a defender, a mediator, an intercessor. We have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. That's what the Bible says. We are unrighteous, made righteous in Christ, but still struggling with sin. So he says the righteous one has gone before us. You should understand and be very grateful for this fact that Jesus is standing before God interceding for you. Amen? By the way, not just because sin separates us from God, it creates this distance in our relationship with Him and broken fellowship. But you should be grateful also because the Bible intimates that you have an adversary before the Father. That the devil himself is before God accusing the brethren. This is what the Bible says, that Satan is before God saying, hey God, can you believe what Trey did? Can you believe the way that guy's living? Can you believe what Daryl has done? Can you believe what Keith did? Can you believe what Dykes did? And Satan is there before the Father accusing you in your sin. But the good news for the believer, you with me, is that Jesus is there pleading our case for him, or before him, pleading our cause as our advocate so that our relationship with God might be maintained. Hebrews chapter 7 says this in verse 25. He is able to save to the uttermost. Look at your neighbor, tell him, he is able. Tell him, he is able. To what? To save you to the uttermost. That means to keep on saving you until you get to heaven. All the way home, he is able to save to the uttermost. Why? Because he ever liveth to make intercession for us. You think the resurrection's important? It's not just important because we have Easter Sunday. It's important because when he rose, he went to heaven, sat down at the right hand of God so he could speak for me until the day that I finally get there. He lives to make intercession. Understand this, that the relationship that God's people had with God was maintained by the intercession of Moses. And for us, it is maintained by the intercession of Jesus. The second thing I want you to write down is that this relationship was healed. It was restored. God said, "I will go with you," because the people repented of their sin. So they had to have the intercession of Moses. There needed to be a mediator. But then there had to be the spirit of repentance in them as well. You see this very clearly. Look at chapter 33, verse number 5, where God said, Therefore now, at the end of the verse, put off thy ornaments from thee. Take off your ornaments. Verse number 6, and the children of Israel stripped themselves of their ornaments by Mount Horeb. Now, what are ornaments? Well, very simply, it's jewelry. That's what it is. It's necklaces and bracelets and bangles and earrings dangling and things up in the women's hair looking all beautiful. It's all of their outward appearance of pretending that they are happy and blessed and well, when in fact the presence of God has moved from them, or they have moved from the presence of God. Now, is this saying that in the new covenant that if we're going to repent, we can't wear earrings or bracelets when we're doing it? I don't think so. Because I would say to you that it's not so much in the wearing of those outward things where we declare that we are okay even when we're not, but it is by the face that we put on to pretend that we have no struggles and life is good and I've got no problems with God whatsoever. Now, I have to tell you, I could preach on this for about an hour and a half and would never run out of material to talk about. You should be glad there's another service coming in 40 minutes, all right? Seriously. Because the fact of the matter is, there's some of us in this room, and if we would be honest, the truth is we moved away from God a long time ago, and we began to live in defiance to His Word, doing what we want to do, and quenching the Holy Spirit's conviction in our lives, and we've been there a long time, and we put on the face that pretends that that's not true, but it is the reality of our hearts. And we would never let a tear of conviction roll down our eye and anybody believe or think for a minute that we don't have it all together. And we would always come in and say, I'm fine, good, how are you? Good, God bless you, we're great, everything's fine. And the truth is, we're living in rot spiritually. And He says, if you want your relationship with God maintained in this world, understand this, there must be the spirit of repentance of sin in you. They laid off their ornaments. We need to lay off the fakeness as well. By the way, you see this beginning in verse number 10, where the Bible says that Moses goes out in verse 9 to the tabernacle, and the scripture says that the people watched him. Look at verse number 8. It says that as he walked out to the tabernacle, all the people rose up, stood every man at his tent door, and looked after Moses until they couldn't see him anymore as he walked into the tent and the cloud came down. It's like they're watching, going, I hope his intercession works. I hope God will go with us. I hope our relationship will be maintained. And verse number 10 says that they bowed down, or they humbled themselves before the Lord. In the same way, if you're listening, say amen. In the same way. If we want our relationship with God to be near, this presence, this communion with God, we must be honest about our wrongdoing, about our struggles, and about our sin. We must be. In fact, the Bible says in Isaiah 51 and verse number 17 that the sacrifice that God receives is the sacrifice of a broken spirit and a contrite heart. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 7 and verse 10 that godly sorrow brings repentance, which leads to life. If you want to walk in fellowship with God, there needs to be a humility and an honesty about your need for God's grace in an ongoing and a continual way in your life. So how was their relationship restored even though they had sinned? It is that Moses interceded and the people repented. Now there's one other thing you need to write down, and this will always be true as our relationship with God is being maintained and restored. It is not only that Moses interceded and they repented, but number two, that God was gracious. All God's people ought to say amen. He's gracious. God was gracious. I love this in verse number 17 when Moses is going before the Lord interceding, and God sees the people laying off their ornaments and having a spirit of repentance. And in verse number 17, the Lord said to Moses, I will do this thing that you have spoken because you have found grace in my sight and I know you by name. In translation, you are my son. You are my beloved son. And even though the people walked away from God, He turned toward them and gave them grace. I mean, imagine, can you imagine the offense in the holiness or to the holiness of God? I mean, imagine this. He had come after 400 years of slavery in Egypt. He had sent them a deliverer. He had led them out of Egypt, protecting them from the judgments that fell upon the Egyptians. He took them to the Red Sea. He parted the Red Sea. He rescued them to the other side of the Red Sea. He gave them manna in the desert, water from a rock, victory over the Amalekites, brought them all the way back to Mount Sinai and entered into a covenant with them. And within 40 days, they've broken the first two commandments and they're dancing naked around the golden calf saying, "We don't know this God that brought us out. Give us an idol that we can worship." Well, if God was not gracious, he would have washed his hands of them and been done with them in that instant. But God is gracious. And in the same way, I can't tell you in the last 34 years how many times God should have looked at Jim Dykes and gone, "I am so finished with you. I've given you so much grace on so many days and in so many ways, and you still walk away from me. I have had it with you." But Jesus pleads my case, and God is gracious, and he says, "I know your name, you belong to me, and I will love you forever." This is the grace of God. And he says to them, "You have found grace in my sight." The scriptures tell us in 1 John chapter 1, verse 9, that if we confess our sins, that he is faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. How was their relationship with God maintained? It was through the mediation, the intercession of Moses, the repentance of the people, and the grace of God. And in the same way, just like Moses, we should never, listen to me, church, if we want to be men and women for the ages, we should never be content to live at a distance from our Heavenly Father. We should never, ever get to the place where it's okay to quench the Spirit, and it's all right to deny the Word of God, and it's okay because, hey, I'm going to heaven. I'll never die. I'll never be have to depart. I'll never be in darkness. So the distance doesn't bother me so bad. I can just live at a guilty distance. We should never, ever, ever be content with that. Like Moses, we ought to want to be in fellowship and communion with the presence of God. Now, all of that said, I want to wrap up by directing your attention to the end of the chapter, because it's out of this joyful assurance of grace and this restored fellowship and relationship with God that Moses has the boldness to ask for a favor that could only be asked by somebody walking in deep fellowship with God. It's an amazing request. Look at verse number 18. After God says, "All right, I'm going with you and you found grace and let's go do this thing." Verse number 18, Moses said, "I beg you, show me your glory." Now, understand, if y'all are listening, say amen. Understand that every time Moses had encountered God previous to verse 18, he had only seen a veiled manifestation of God's glory. He had never seen the unveiled glory of God, ever. God says, "You can't see my face and live." So he had seen God in the burning bush, and he had seen God and encountered God in the cloud and in the pillar of fire, and he had seen God in these veiled manifestations. But in verse number 18, he says, "If I've really found grace in your sight and I really belong to you and we really have this communion, I want to see more of you." What a request! And God says, "Done. But I'm going to tell you how we're going to do it." Look at verse number 19. "I will make all my great goodness to pass before you. I will proclaim the name of the Lord. Be gracious to whom I will be gracious, show mercy to whom I will show mercy." Verse 20, "You cannot see my face and live. No man can see my face and live." Verse 21, here's how we'll do it. "Behold, there is a place next to me." I'm going to bring you into a place next to me, by me. "You stand upon the rock. I'm going to come by." Verse number 22. "And it shall come to pass that while my glory passes by, that I will put you in the cleft of the rock." Now, the word cleft just means a low place or an indention or maybe a little cave or grotto. It's just a place that Moses could tuck back in into the rock. He says, "I'm going to put you in there. I'm going to cover you with my hand while I pass. And when I get by you, I'll move my hand and you'll be able right next to me to see the hinder parts of my glory." Wow. By the way, this happened. And this, if you read the rest, we're out of time. Like, we got to end the series today. But keep reading the rest of Exodus. You'll find out that when Moses comes off the mountain after this experience, he's seen the glory of God so fully that the people can't even look at him. His face is reflecting the holiness and the glory of God. Remember, that's what he was passionate about, that the holiness of God would be seen in his people. And they had to cover his face with a veil to even look at him. And Moses saw the glory of God. Here's what I want you to know, that though you and I are sinners, and we're sinners like everybody else in the world, through the intercession of Jesus Christ, the contrition and repentance and honesty of our hearts before him, and the grace of God, we are invited to rest in Jesus by God and see the glory of God. This is grace. When God could have and rightly should have rejected us forever and gone nowhere with us, he says, there is a place by me. There is a rock. There's a cleft in the rock. In that place is where you can have fellowship with me. Now we know, don't we, that Jesus is our rock. And that Jesus has been cleft for us, that he has been broken for us, and that when we are in Christ, covered by the gracious hand of God, that we are next to him and we encounter his glory. You probably noticed when you came in today that we're going to receive communion. There's the trays on the platform, and the reason we're receiving communion today is because we want to have communion with Christ in this reality. Moses was serious about his fellowship with God, the nearness, the presence of God among them. And in the same way, we want to have nearness with God, to seek communion with God through the brokenness of Christ. Let me read you a verse out of 1 Corinthians chapter number 10. The Bible says in verse 16, "The cup of blessing which we bless, is it not the communion with the blood of Christ? And the bread which we break, is it not the communion of the body of Christ?" You see, what Paul says is that when I take the cup of communion and the bread of communion, I am in fellowship with the reality of the breaking of Jesus' body and the shedding of his blood. So that knowing that his body was broken and his blood was shed, it becomes possible for me to walk in fellowship with God and to see and know the glory of God. So here's what we're going to do. In just a few minutes, there are some folks who are going to serve you. They're going to serve you bread and juice. When you receive the bread and juice, don't partake, just hold it. And as we're serving, I want to ask that no one moves at all. No one leaves the room. Ushers, no one comes in the room. No one moves. And during this moment that you are reflecting, can I say it this way? That you're laying off the ornaments, okay? And that you're saying to God, hey, I need your intercession, Lord Jesus, and I need your grace, God. And I know that Jesus' body was broken and blood was shed for me. And I'm going to lean into the rock of Christ so that I can see the glory of God and have fellowship with him. Now, some of you here maybe don't know Jesus as your Savior. And if you've never received Jesus Christ, then I'm going to give you an opportunity to do that in just a minute, where you can trust Jesus to forgive you of your sins and take you to heaven. I'll give you a chance to do that before we partake. For the next few minutes, very quietly, very humbly, let's receive these elements, repent before God, thank him for his grace, thank him for Jesus, and then we'll partake in just a moment together.